Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
Up above the world, so high, like a diamond in the sky.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
Hey again, everyone. This is a follow-up to the past Tortoise TTS video that I put up a little while ago, so I'm not going over the basic installation and use here. What I want to look at here is a method of generating voices a little bit faster using Tortoise TTS, which we'll accomplish by fine-tuning a model in order to reduce the size of the domain that needs to be sampled to synthesize decent-sounding speech, invest a little more time with the setup to save much more time in the future. This method is only really useful if you're working with a specific voice and will take some trial and error, as the outcome is dependent on your training data, training parameters, and the cosmic alignment of the zodiac, and whether or not you assembled all the pieces of the magic amulet and said the incantations correctly. Fine-tuning also more or less locks the model on only being able to speak in that voice, even if the conditioning latents for another voice are applied. You may be able to slightly alter it by applying other voice latents, but not to the degree of the original trained model. You may be able to fix this by lowering the learning rate and training for longer, but I haven't had too much success with that. Tortoise TTS excels at zero-shot voice cloning, but to produce decent quality output, the sampler typically needs to be set high. I'll use the GUI presets as a comparison here. The ultra-fast preset has the sampler at 16, and the fast preset has the value at 96. With random voices, you may be able to get decent speech at 16 or 96, but may notice speech sounding unnatural as soon as you try to supply your own set of samples for zero-shot cloning. By aligning the model more closely to your samples through fine-tuning, you can get similar or better sounding speech with a lower sampler value. If you're going to try to fine-tune a model rather than use zero-shot cloning, the audio samples you use for training need to be high quality. Any noise will be picked up by the model and carried over into your voice.
Hickory dickory dock. The mouse ran up the clock. The clock struck down. The mouse ran down. Hickory dickory dock. Hickory dickory dock. The mouse ran up the clock. The clock struck two. The mouse went boom. Hickory dickory dock.
With a larger dataset and longer training, a few noisy clips may not be such a problem, but consistent noise throughout your dataset will be picked up by the trained voice. For the purposes of this video, a small dataset will be anything around 10 to 50 clips, and a large dataset is, let's say, 2,000 or more. My clip length is typically between 3 and 10 seconds when I'm making datasets. I've gathered some character voice samples from the Blade Runner film for testing. The disc audio track was pulled, then I grabbed the audio channels with the highest speech volume and passed that through Demux to separate the speech from the background audio. It worked decently well, but some scenes required more processing with other tools like Deep Filter. After doing this, I'm shocked by just how little dialogue there is in this movie. For a movie I've heard described as a boring talking movie, there's relatively little dialogue. There were a few successful training runs and a few failures. I'll go over some of both, which may save you some time if you give this a try. Before getting into training, let's take a look at some of the samples that I've gathered for each of the voices. Some of these were clipped manually and some were done using dataset tools I've used in other videos. I'll try to point out any major flaws in the clips. I'll go through the clips of Rick Deckard that I clipped. There were something like 57 or so clips. And then I'll have some near duplicates in the dataset because I'm including both pre- and post-processed audio files.
Orange body, green legs. Watched her build a web all summer. Then one day there's a big egg in it. The egg hatched.
This isn't too bad, but there's a little noise at the end that needs to be trimmed or silenced. Here's the same clip after being processed with Deep Filter.
Orange body, green legs. Watched her build a web all summer, and one day there's a big egg in it. The egg hatched.
Much cleaner overall, but removing the noise at the end degraded the speech, so that bit of the clip should ideally be trimmed. Here's another pair of clips, pre- and post-processing with Deep Filter.
Abdul Hassan, Artificial Snake License XB71, that's you? This is your work, huh?
The first clip isn't noisy, but it is quite muffled. I'm still going to use it because the dataset is so small, and the voice still sounds clear.
Abdul Hassan, Artificial Snake License XB71, that's you? This is your work, huh? Who did you sell it to?
Deep Filter did a good job removing the little scratching sounds in the clip. If I'm making a dataset for Tortoise TTS and I only have a little bit of speech to work with, I'd probably keep both clips in the dataset, then discard the noiser clip when generating the latents. I'll just play a few more raw samples from the characters so you can see the data I'm working with.
I'm lost. Pris.
Hi.
We scared each other pretty good, didn't we?
I don't have one.
I'm hungry, Jaya. I was hoping you'd say that.
I wanted to see you. I don't know why he told you what he did. He wouldn't see me.
You think I'm a replicant, don't you?
Look.
It's me with my mother.
Morphology, longevity, incept dates.
If only you could see what I've seen with your eyes. Questions.
After assembling your set of audio clips, bring up the training tab and go to prepare dataset. Check the box slice segments to trim the clips into optimal length segments for the trainer. I haven't been using trim silence because it seems like including lengthy pauses with a small data set will force the model to take on the speaker's prosody, but you may have better results trimming silence. Select the whisper model to use for transcription, and then click transcribe and process. After this is complete, you'll have a subdirectory under the training directory with the name of your new voice. Inside the training voice directory, there is a folder named audio alongside the training metadata files. Later on, I'll talk about using the latents generated from the voice directory rather than the training dataset. To use the voice folder, you will need to move the metadata files and rename or move the audio folder from the training directory. Otherwise, the web UI will attempt to use the training dataset to calculate latents. In some cases, this isn't helpful because averaging the voice data across the whole dataset may give too general a representation of the voice. Selecting the best audio samples and putting them in the voice directory with your voice name after removing the dataset audio and metadata files, then restarting the web UI may produce better output. But that's for later. Now I'll go over some of the training parameters I've used for small dataset fine-tuning. Currently, it looks like there's an issue with how the trainer calculates and reports epoch count and iterations. So it's an awkward time to be talking about this because the underlying calculation in the web UI could change. I think it's isolated to the save step count though, and could be fixed at any time, but I did want to mention it because it's caused me a couple minor headaches. It seems the save interval in the training configuration is double what is entered into the web UI. If you notice checkpoints not being saved at expected intervals, this may be why. With that out of the way, let's continue. After the web UI handled the splitting of clips, and with the duplications of some regular and denoised clips, here's how the training data and training parameters broke down for each voice.
The Deckard voice had 125 training elements with batch size 64 and 2 iterations per epoch. The trainer used mega batch size or grad accumulation of 32. The learning rate for all tests is the default 1E-5 using cosine annealing with 4 restarts and trained for 200 epochs.
The Roy Batkey's voice was only 13 elements using batch size 8. It used 2 iterations per epoch, a grad accumulation of 4, and it was trained for 200 epochs.
The Rachel voice had 23 elements with a batch size of 16. It used 2 iterations per epoch, a grad accumulation of 4, and was also trained for 200 epochs.
The Pris voice had 26 elements using a batch size 16. With 2 iterations per epoch. They used a grad accumulation of 4 and was trained for 200 epochs.
I haven't bothered with loss targeting because the small datasets make it inconsistent to compare between datasets. The Roy voice is the only real failure, but a lot of the clips were very noisy, and they carried over into the fine-tuned voice. With such a small dataset, I'm surprised how much it captured the character's odd speech pattern. When it comes to generating using your fine-tuned model, you have 2 options for the computed latents. Use the dataset or use the files in the voice directory. If you use the dataset, it may take a long time to calculate, and maybe an overly generalized sample. If you use the files in the voice directory, you can select a small subset of the best quality voice samples to use. To use the voice directory, move the audio folder and the metadata files from the voice's fine-tuning directory to somewhere else. Then, refresh the voice list. You may or may not need to restart the web UI. After switching to the fine-tuned model and computing the voice latents, you're ready to generate speech. If your fine-tuned model is a good representation of your sample voice, you can reduce the sample rate slider to as low as 2. To make the output sound less metallic and robotic, raise the iteration slider. Raising the iteration seems to increase generation time linearly, whereas the sample rate seems to increase generation time exponentially.
The itsy bitsy spider crawled up the water spout. Down came the rain. We washed the spider out. Out came the sun and dried up all the rain. And the itsy bitsy spider went up the spout again.
All of the sample output in the video was done with sampler at 2. You will get weird sentence endings occasionally. This gets better with larger datasets. And yes, output is inconsistent. This is a diffusion model. Inconsistent is sort of what you're going for. The output is less uniform and mechanical than other types of text-to-speech models.
Hickory dickory dock. The mouse ran up the clock. The clock struck one. The mouse ran down. Hickory dickory dock. Hickory dickory dock. The mouse ran up the clock. The clock struck two. The mouse went boo. Hickory dickory dock.
Although it's currently somewhat limited to English, with fine-tuning, adjusting the generation parameters, and carefully selecting clips for calculating the voice latents, Tortoise TTS becomes a lot easier to use. Generation time with a fine-tuned model may be as low as 10 to 25% of the original generation time for similar quality output. That's all I wanted to cover in this one. If you found this video helpful, please help share it on forums or Discord, or leave a message or comment to help it out on the algorithm. Back again soon with another Tortoise TTS video, probably on attempting to force it to speak other languages, but I'm still banging my head against the desk on that one.
When the blazing sun is gone, when he nothing shines upon.
When you shower your little light, twinkle, twinkle, all the night.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.